Let me make a few comments. I believe that Latinos are a misunderstood people in the sense that people think that we are one culture, one race. Now, we are not one culture or one race. As we all know, we are many races and many cultures unified by the wonderful language Español. Now, the reason for that is that we'll sleep with anybody. We are equal opportunity lovers, especially after two tequilas, maybe three for the more conservative. But what it comes down to, as you know, when we conquered, yeah, we did some killing, but mostly we did a lot of intercoursing. And that's why we are the mixed people that we are. And that's why we have so many problems. That's why we can never agree on anything. But one thing we can agree on is the fact that we are proud to be who we are, and we are proud of each other's successes. Now, as an actor, I experienced this when I, you know, go to different places across this country, and people recognize me for my work on television, my work in film, etc. But what's interesting is that sometimes the love that people have for us overflows to such an extent that it creates a certain amount of confusion. Because sometimes people come up to me and say, "Are you George Lopez?" I don't quite know how to answer something like that. It leaves me speechless, so I go home, look in the mirror, and I say, "I'm ugly, but I'm not that ugly." Now, sometimes it isn't such a humbling experience. Sometimes someone will come up to me full of love for Latino celebrities, and they'll say, "Excuse me, but are you Antonio Banderas?" And then I experience something completely different. I look at them right in the eye and I go, "Yes? What can I do for you?" But I think my favorite of all recognition moments, especially after Ugly Betty, was such an amazing success. And they do call me Ugly Daddy, because it wasn't the mother that made her ugly. I was mostly responsible for that. But actually, she wasn't ugly at all. She's gorgeous. But after that success, and by the way, Ugly Betty is the most successful Latino-based show in history, by the way. It was, and we'll have to create another one pretty soon. It was the first Latino show-based show that actually was a crossover hit. 80% of our audience was non-ethnic. In other words, 80% were non-black, non-brown, non-Asian. They were Anglos watching a Latino-based show, as it should be. Now, if anybody knows about Hollywood, you know that except for Ugly Betty and a few exceptions like Resurrection Boulevard, American Family, The George Lopez Show, we haven't been on TV that much. And in 50 years of television, 50 plus years of television, I think it's almost 60, we still only are represented at a 2 or 3% level. Now, given the fact that we represent almost 15, 16% of the population, that's not acceptable. And I tell you two things why that occurs. Because in many ways, we have yet to penetrate the halls of power and decision-making in Hollywood. Too many of our Latinos are only vice presidents of diversity and not vice presidents of development. And many of our writers, directors, producers are caught in the catch-22 of not being able to get in because they don't have enough experience and not having enough experience in order to get in. So something must be done because how they perceive us on television, and I'm not speaking about the 6 o'clock news, how they perceive us on television and in film influences greatly how they perceive us in society. Now, if we were to make everybody here an honorary Chicano, their credit rating would drop about 40 points. And they would have difficulty in getting a house, getting a job, etc. But their greatest difficulty would be getting into Hollywood and playing people of their own educational level. In 35 years, I can count on my two hands how many times I have played characters on television that are at the same educational level as I am. So let me tell you that I have played every stereotype except for the pregnant teenager. But as a good actor, if given the chance and the right wig, I'd give it a shot. So something must be done about changing how we are perceived, how we are portrayed, and to what extent we are portrayed in Hollywood, in film and television. Until the day when our representation equals the 15% of our population, we will not be looking at an equal playing field. Until the day when we are represented across all socioeconomic levels, all professions, we will not be experiencing an equal playing field. That holds true for the rest of society, but it holds true more than ever for Hollywood. So as I challenge LULAC to work with us in Hollywood to make that change a reality. And I'll stop preaching there. And that's a perfect segue into our next portion of our program. Almost 50 years ago, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and his supporters endured a dangerous and deadly march between Selma and Montgomery, Alabama. It was a struggle to preserve the minority right to vote. This past March, LULAC members joined others from all over the country to walk in Dr. King's steps. It was then, as it is now, about securing the future for our children. Please turn your attention toward the screens.
En este mundo tan lindo y tan grande, yo puedo realizar mis sueños. Porque sé que sí se puede. Sí se puede. Sí se puede. Sí se puede.
Si se puede, the battle cry of the 1970s galvanized international support for the United Farm Workers Union. It is still a powerful reminder that great things can happen when people of all colors unite to protect our future.
President Johnson addresses a joint session of Congress to push a voting rights bill aimed at ending discrimination. It would appoint federal voting registrars in some instances, and put an end to complicated literacy tests and other hampering tactics.
Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around, turn me around.
When Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and his supporters undertook the historic march from Selma to Montgomery to protect the minority right to vote, they could not have taken that first step unless they believed in Si Se Puede.
The time has come now to draw the line. You know you got to stand, stand. I stand for what you believe.
In March of 2012, LULAC members joined others to retrace Dr. King's historic civil rights journey.
Stand for what you believe.
Well, I think what the March to Selma, the original march with Dr. King, represents is a commitment to human rights and an awareness, a consciousness that that he brought out in the nation.
When you were in the church, tell me about that feeling.
It was magical. It was kind of like you were sitting there and you touched the booths and the pews, and you said, they sat here. The people that had made the movement and made our civil rights, what it is today, sat where I'm sitting right now.
It's absurd to me that we came so far so many years ago and then we hit the same road bumps all over again. It just doesn't really make sense that a lot of people don't see that parallel.
And we will cry together, and we'll fight this together, and we'll be strong together, stand together, pray together, rise up when you feel you can't go on.
Woo! This is an incredibly important fight that we're in, and I hope that Latinos respond by saying, you know what, I'm not going to let somebody take my vote away.
And when the tears starts to fall, rise up. And you feel you've given it your all, rise up. When your back is up again.
I thought that by doing this, that we could show our youth, our kids, that maybe weren't there in the 60s, that didn't go through that, that is something that we cannot put up with, and we need to, you know, raise our voices and say, that was wrong, it's wrong now.
We'll fight this together,
stand up and fight,
and we'll be strong together,
stand together,
pray together,
rise up.
Keep climbing, keep moving. If you can't fly, run. If you can't run, walk. If you can't walk, crawl. But by all means, keep moving.
Rise up.